Welcome to the maiden edition of Hard Copy, a program that focuses on real conversations with people in the news. I'm Maope Ogun. My very first guest is Nigeria's Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, a senior advocate of Nigeria, who spoke frankly with me on some issues, top among them the fight against corruption, handling the recession, and restructuring. Professor Osinbajo once made reference to the urgency of the change Nigerians will be expecting when voted into office. He illustrated it with the scenario of being on the bus with the president, who told him that the moment their party wins the elections, the faces pressing against their campaign bus would expect an instant change. I began by asking him that if he were to return to that same trail today, in that same bus, how much change would he be able to tell those faces that this administration has brought to them?
Well, I think I'll quickly be able to say first, security in the Northeast. Just even this last Sallah, loads of places where people couldn't even pray before. And now they're now able to go back there and pray. Loads of places that were considered completely unsafe are now safe. Many people are going back to their homes. We still have a humanitarian problem. But by and large, you know, you would find that in the Northeast, there has been tremendous progress. There's been peace has returned to many, many of the portions of the Northeast that were completely impassable, uninhabitable before now. So in the area of security, I think we can say that we've done quite well. There's been a fair amount of change there. Also in the anti-corruption fight, that's also a very major issue for us. As you know, I mean, a lot of what we're trying to account for in this country, I mean, a lot of what has held us back is grand corruption, corruption on the scale that is able to cripple an economy and that has crippled the economy to a certain extent. So we've done quite a bit of work in the area of anti-corruption, and I think that those are areas that we can really say that to a certain extent we brought about change. But again, it's ongoing. There is nothing, I mean, we're pushing, we're working as hard as we can to improve on all of those areas. With respect to the economy, obviously there are challenges, you know, and it is in the area of the economy that, you know, a lot of people will say, hey, we really would like you to tell us about food on the table, we'd like you to tell us about jobs and those kinds of things. So there we certainly have challenges. But I think one of the most important things, especially about, you know, the challenges we have with the economy, is that we need to understand why we're where we are, because that's crucial. The kind of recession, I mean, everywhere in the world, I mean, obviously people talk about recessions when there is a recession, but every recession has its own cause, you know, or its own causes, if you like. But just look at the immediate cause of the Nigerian recession, the immediate cause. I mean, aside from all sorts of structural problems, which we might get a chance to talk about, but the immediate cause was first the sharp drop. Aside from the drop in oil prices, that's minor compared to the sharp drop in production caused by the vandalization of pipelines. I mean, our budget estimate was 2.2 million barrels a day. So we expected revenue even at $38. But by the time the Transfocados line was blown up, by the time the Tembisa Brass, to Brass pipeline was blown up, by the time Kwaibo was blown up, by the time the Nembe Creek axis was blown up, all of these supplying petrol, supplying crude to Bonny, by the time those were blown up, we were losing about 1 million barrels every day.
Was that not something that, you know, this administration would have envisaged? Because, you know, some people would have said that considering the political upheaval, it was saying, yes, you know, that happened in the wake of your coming to office,
yes,
that there ought to have been, you know, means or processes of reconciling the different people who would have felt, you know, distraught at the fact that they lost the elections.
First, let me explain that there's no way in the world that anyone could possibly have predicted the sheer scale. Don't forget that before now, we'd even been having problems with pipeline vandalization, but they were not blowing up export terminals. Here I've mentioned four export terminals that were blown up. This is unprecedented, completely unprecedented, when you're losing 1 million barrels of oil every day. Even if we thought, oh, there might be vandalization, so let's even think about some shortages. No one would have expected that four different export terminals or five different export terminals, major export terminals, will be blown up. So that kind of, I mean, there's no way anyone plans. I mean, you're not in a war situation. And in any event, what really changed? This was February 2016, by the way. We had been in office from May, and, you know, nothing changed in our relationship with anybody in the Niger Delta. Nothing really changed. As a matter of fact, we were maintaining all of the amnesty program and all of those things. The amnesty program, nothing was reduced. Nothing changed. So, and that's one of the reasons why, obviously, I mean, there.
But some of the Niger Delta militants were moved against. Tompolo, Enko were moved against the security agencies, and they would have seen it as an affront, wouldn't they?
Yes. But
so would we have expected, because we at some point, I recall that during the Yar'Adua days, before amnesty was introduced, we were at 700,000 barrels per day. The nation was almost on its knees when amnesty program was introduced.
Yes.
So can we really say that we've never been here before?
No, we've never been at the prices. We're talking of the prices. I mean, if you're at 100, 115, if you're 100, 115 and you're even doing a million barrels, you're doing very well. If obviously, if you're at 1 million barrels or under 1 million barrels and you're selling at 40, I mean, in terms of just the proportions, at some point, you know, we're doing about 385 billion a month on, you know, oil proceeds. 2-3 months ago, we're down to 55 billion to just tell you the scale. I mean, this is a huge shock. You're looking at well over 60% of income lost in the process. The other thing about Tompolo, you know, and all of the involvement, his involvement in, you know, in some of the huge scams that went on in Nimasa at the time, you cannot fail, you know, as a government to hold people to account. I mean, Nimasa is a government, is a government agency, which aside from revenue generation, is also meant to protect. It's also meant to protect the brown water area of the Delta. If you fail to hold a person who is accused of taking away billions of naira and dollars also, what sort of government is that? The first priority of government must be law and order.
That's, is there a truce on that now?
Truce how?
I mean, the government, I think, at some point, was that the courts declared him wanted.
Yes.
But he was seen going for his father's burial, and
obviously he didn't. Obviously, he wouldn't notify anyone. He's still, as far as we know, he's still declared wanted. He's still, there is still an ongoing prosecution. There's still an ongoing trial. You know, where he went to his father's funeral and all of that, obviously it wouldn't have been publicized and all of that. But he's obviously still a person who is on trial and who should report for trial.
Mr. Vice President, there were already signs that the economy was in trouble before this administration took over. Oil prices were already declining. And I recall that when you were campaigning on the campaign trail, one of the questions we put to you is, how do you intend to fulfill most of the promises, especially the social safety net promises, considering that oil prices were dwindling, our oil reserves were also going down, and there were quite a number of issues. One of the things I recall you said was that you're going to block the leakages of corruption.
Yes.
But it would seem now that, you know, there's been criticism that there was a lack of urgency in terms of, you know, realizing that the economy was in trouble.
Let me say that clearly, you know, we had planned for what was foreseeable. What was foreseeable was that with low oil prices, we needed to restructure our budget and also even restructure some of our programs. So we decided $38 a barrel, 2.2 million barrels a day, which is, you know, which at the time was even considered conservative. As a matter of fact, we were being asked to reduce that to $35 a barrel. But we stuck to $38 a barrel. And in terms of planning and in terms of being far-sighted, with all humility, we were far-sighted because till today, it's still $38 a barrel. What we could never have planned for was that four export terminals will be blown up.
Which flows into my next question on restructuring. It's something that, you know, has popped up before. It's popping up again, especially in the face of the recession. I think it was a debate on the floor of the Senate, you know, where senators were saying that perhaps if we had restructured some time back and states were a little more autonomous and could make their own monies, perhaps we would not have found ourselves here. Do you agree with them? And are you, is it something that this administration is considering?
Well, let me say first, you know, I functioned for years as a state official. I was Attorney General in Lagos. And we did a lot of work in terms of litigation, in trying to find autonomy for the states. So by and large, I mean, for example, look at the whole, you know, what they call fiscal restructuring. We said that a state government should be able to keep as much of what it makes as possible. The problem we've always had is not so much the restructuring. It is more the fact that there is oil, there is money to be shared. When there was oil and plenty of it, it just, we went to court, and I'll give you an example. We went to court saying, let us have, fiscal autonomy. Let every state keep its mind. This was the so-called resource control case and all of that. Several states refused to back Lagos State's call at that time. In fact, practically every state, except four states, agreed that there should be fiscal restructuring. Everybody else disagreed, said no. We said, okay, VAT, VAT. We also went to court on VAT. We said, hey, look, let everyone keep the VAT. It was widely opposed by most states. So you see, even this call for restructuring, you know, sometimes, you know, you find that there's very little sincerity around it. Even a lot of the senators that are talking about restructuring and all of that. I mean, the question is, when the rubber really hits the road, how many people are really going to be able to stand up and say, let's have complete autonomy of the states? I am one for saying that as much as possible, states should have autonomy in the sense that they should at least provide their own income.
So, looking more keenly, say at the 2014 National Conference and the reports that came out of it, is it something that this administration will consider?
Well, let me say that there are several things that were in the 2014 National Conference, were several, and several that we're already even working at. But you see, if you look at the 2014 report, there were about 50 or so odd states that are supposed to be created. I think about 50, I can't remember how many, but an incredibly large number of states. How do you implement that? I mean, today.
But you say you're already working on some of them. Can you give us an example?
Yeah. For example, one of the things I've said is about autonomy, about trying to give the states more room to operate. You know, and that's one of the things that we're doing. We're at the NEC, for example, at the National Economic Council. That's one of the major areas that we're working on. What is it that the states need to have? Well, for instance, the CBN. What we're trying to get the CBN to do is to fund state projects. You know, we are also funding state projects to the extent that we're trying to get the states to be as independent as they can, given the constraints that there is. For instance, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when we were not in office, who would say that the federal government would actually support states from federal resources? Nobody would do that. But we're doing that. We're trying to ensure that we are able to support the states to become independent, to do their own thing. We're also, one of the issues that was raised was also the issue of taxation. We're also looking at trying to take a second look at the tax policies, see what we can do about VAT, see what we can do about what the states will do. We're presenting a report. The economic management team is looking at the tax issues and trying to present a report. As far as we are concerned, the more the states can do, the better. The more the states take the burden, the better. There are those who have been saying, oh, what we really need is reallocation of resources, this and that, this and that. Again, we're back to sharing money. Ideologically, there's something wrong with that. When you're saying, we want state autonomy, but we want more share of this national cake.
Maybe that's in the meantime, you know. If that is not coming, you know, let's do this in the meantime. You don't agree?
The The paradox in the Nigerian situation can sometimes elicit laughter. But find out what his response was to whether or not the federal government should shed some of the 52.8% that currently accrues to it from the Federation account.